Tonight on Nova Science Now, is it possible to begin with dust, lifeless chemicals?
Not alive.
Then following DNA recipes in just the right order, could scientists build a living creature?
The steps we have to take are getting smaller and smaller.
But could we actually create life?
We're going to have laboratory life. This is really knocking on the door.
Not only can we, these scientists say, we will. And trying to explain what goes on in the brain of, say, this crow, who on her own devised a tool to fish for food. Did it once, did it again.
That's tool making.
This little bird is doing this with the intent to get the food.
And this scientist wants other scientists to know that a bird brain is brainier than we ever knew. Then, a team of investigators.
Go ahead, you get in position.
Working with balloons. And rockets.
Fire.
Are unlocking the secrets of lightning. They're discovering that the true source of lightning may not be what's in a cloud or on the ground, but what provides the trigger for lightning might be energy from deep space. All that and more tonight on Nova Science Now.
Yeah!
Welcome to Nova Science Now. I'm Robert Krulwich, and in this hour, from a number of different perspectives, we're going to look at the mystery of being alive. After all, what are living things made of? We are made of chemicals, carbon, hydrogen, simple chemicals. You could buy them at a store. But you put these chemicals together in just the right way, and you get a breathing, living being. Life is not an unfathomable mystery. Scientists say, this is a piece of chemical engineering. This is a beautiful chemical machine. And one day they say, we're going to build a creature from scratch, simpler than this. But the surprise is that that day may be getting much, much closer. You know those Hollywood movies?
Throw the switches.
The ones where scientists do improbable things.
It's alive! It's alive! It's alive!
They mess with life. Then they get a little confident.
I know what it feels like to be gone. You're crazy.
But what if I told you that there are dozens of scientists right now trying to do something much like that? I mean, they're not stealing dead organs in the dark of night or constructing a 7-foot creature with bolts in its neck. But starting with dry, dead dust, they're working on tiny life forms. Racing for the big prize. They want to be the first to turn non-life into self-sustaining living creatures.
We're going to have laboratory life. This is really knocking on the door.
As best we can tell, there hasn't been a completely new life form for the last 3.5 billion years. Not since the first act of creation. But you are about to meet scientists who say, we can do it again.
The steps we have to take are getting smaller and smaller.
It's doable and it's relatively cheap.
And what's most amazing and in some ways a little frightening is that some of them say it's not going to be that hard.
Compared to, making the bomb or sending people to the moon, I think it's significantly easier.
Easier to create life from scratch than making a bomb?
Yeah, easier, significantly easier, yeah.
Why easier? Because, say the scientists who do this, life has a rough formula, and we know that formula.
So this is your place?
This is it.
What's it called?
This is DNA 2.0. We make DNA.
You make DNA?
We make DNA.
The same DNA that builds living creatures?
Exactly. Yes.
Exactly? Do you mean exactly?
I mean exactly.
And if you wanted to order some DNA for, say, an experiment, a company like Jeremy Minchell's could custom make it for you. In other words, it's kind of like DNA to go.
To go.
DNA being, of course, the recipe for living creatures built from chemical ingredients abbreviated A, C, T, and G. So if I'm a creature, let's suppose I'm a very small creature. I'm not going to be anything immodest like a cat or a mouse. But I'm just a little itty-bitty thing. And you can spell me C-C-C-T-T-T-G-G-G. Do you have all those chemicals here?
Absolutely, and we could make you.
A bold statement.
Well, he doesn't mean that literally, but right away I could tell that Jeremy and I don't look at life the same way.
What do you see?
When I look at, let's say, jellyfish, I see a weird, pulsing, hairy creature. When he looks at the same thing, at least during business hours, he sees a blueprint, a chemical formula.
Those letters carry all of the information that makes us.
And while we've known for a while how to read DNA recipes, even cut and splice genetic engineering, now at companies like Jeremy's, they can write recipes, create genes from scratch that never existed.
So if I call you up on the phone and say, can you make me something that would, in a living creature, make it glow green, you'd know what I need?
Exactly. We would know just what you need.
This, for example, is a bottle of tea standing for thymine.
Can I have your hand?
And this is what it looks like.
So here we go. It's just powder.
It's just powder.
Is this in any way alive?
This is in no way alive.
So this is just dust?
Just dust.
Not alive.
So Jeremy mixes this dust with some liquid chemical, still not alive, and hooks them all up to this machine.
So now it's a solution in all these things.
It's got the A's, C's, and T's in bottles tucked in here. And you just type in whatever recipe you want, and the machine pumps out the letters of life.
So it'll go C and C and C and T and T and T.
That's right.
The machine makes dozens of strands of letters, and then some other machines mix them all together, and automatically they self-assemble.
They self-organize.
In the right order.
In the right order.
Jeremy plugs the completed gene into bacteria, and look at this. The bacteria glow.
Our instructions were followed, and it's making green glow.
So for about $900, starting literally with chemical dust, we have just made not quite life, but a gene. A gene that never existed before.
Then will you mail me the genes?
That's exactly what we'll do.
So all this is just going around through the mail all the time.
That's
right, you say.
Yeah.
This is all new to me.
And if it's that easy to construct individual genes from scratch, some of these folks say, well, why stop there? Why not build all the genes to make up a creature? And amazingly, a couple of years ago, scientists created the DNA for a whole virus. They copied the DNA recipe, then got it through the membrane of the cell, and the cell manufactured a burst of new viruses, just like happens in real life. So would this count as life?
No, it would not.
Sorry, says biologist Francis Collins.
Because remember, what you're making in this machine is not life. You're making DNA. And DNA is just the instruction book, but an instruction book doesn't actually build anything.
So it's the living cell that does the real work here. DNA by itself does not create life.
So I would say that was not life.
So then what is life? What exactly do you need? Well, one basic definition says that life requires a bunch of things. A container, something to live in. The ability to use energy to grow or change. The ability to reproduce, to create creatures that look like yourself. And for some, the ability to evolve. But making a creature from scratch that meets all four requirements is much, much harder than making a gene. In fact, no one's been able to do it. But now, scientists all over the world are working on different parts of this puzzle. One of them is Dave Diemer, who's looking for clues in the distant past. Today, his quest brings him to the remote mountains of Northern California, to a very strange place.
This is Bumpus Hell. We are in hell.
And Bumpus Hell is on Mount Lassen, an active volcano.
This is one of the few places on the Earth that we think resembles what the prebiotic Earth was like. Hot, boiling water, mud, clay.
This is the kind of place, Dave thinks, where life might have emerged the first time around. The question is, how did that happen?
One of the great remaining questions of science. Nobody yet knows how life began.
Our best guess is that life at the beginning, and we're talking 3.5 billion years ago, must have been made of ingredients that were either lying around on the early Earth or brought in from space on meteorites or comets. And the first life must have been very simple. just a little bubble-like container with a little bit of chemistry going on inside. That's one of Dave's hopes today, that he can use the environment of this pond to get some primitive chemical changes going. The powder he's got here contains some basic building blocks that could have existed back then.
We're going to get some of this hot water into this little mixture of organic chemicals. These are biochemicals.
Then he spikes the pool with these basic ingredients, takes a sample of the mixture. So, has he created life?
Nothing popped out yet that's wiggling.
Well, he didn't expect that. But he is hoping that the chemicals in this pond will be able to build life requirement number one, a container. Because Dave has already found that tiny containers, kind of like primitive cell membranes, can form on their own. He did it in a lab from chemicals that he found on this rock, the famous Murchison meteorite.
There's nothing alive in a meteorite, and yet the components, the organic components in the meteorite, have the property of self-assembly into these microscopic bubble-like structures.
And they did it.
And they did it.
So they can make mini containers from scratch. Then in Switzerland, they got those containers to grow. At Harvard, they got them to divide. At RPI in New York, they got different chemicals to assemble into a gene-like shape. And at MIT, they got a primitive gene to start to copy itself.
We know how to make things grow. We know how to make things reproduce. We know how to make things evolve, in a sense. So we can do all those things.
And since they can do all this stuff, they say soon they can put it all together and build an entire living thing. Microscopic, yeah, but alive.
We feel like we're on the verge of making a huge new discovery.
This is coming. There's no, it's a tidal wave we can see in the distance, and it's going to come. It's going to hit us. There's no discussion about that.
No discussion? But what about the people who believe that life requires something more than just chemistry?
What would you say to the person who said, no, you need a kiss from God or a bit of lightning or something mysterious and magical to go from one state to the other?
If I want to talk about this poetically, I think it is a little bit magic. But all you doesn't matter what you look at in your life, there is magic in that.
But still, when Steen Rasmussen and all the scientists we talk to look at life up close, right into a cell, life is not a poem.
Life is a machine.
It's essentially a collection of molecules. There's nothing else that's there.
It is a molecular machine that does certain things.
And if you buy into the notion that life is chemistry, rules, and structure, if life is a machine, then we can build it.
These guys, they organize themselves all by themselves.
Steen's idea for building life is perhaps the most radical of all because it is so extraordinarily simple.
What we are trying to do is a sort of the absolutely minimal form of life you can imagine. It is it's a million times smaller than the simplest, lousiest little organism we know today.
So all the greasy stuff will sort of...
The creature Steen has designed and is now trying to build has no cell membrane, just an oily blob. No DNA. Instead of DNA, a man-made chemical not found in nature.
And our protoorganism grows, it swells up as it eats all the food.
But can you build something so alien from life as we know it?
Do I believe that you can make life that is different from life as we know it? Oh, absolutely, I do believe that.
We need this guy to digest his food.
If Steen can get his newfangled creature, this homemade alien, to meet life's requirements...
If someone creates an alien on Earth, if you can do that, now you're talking. Now I'm going to bring you on my spaceship because I want you to help me find life elsewhere in the cosmos.
Astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson says we've got no idea if life is even possible without the usual ingredients. But if Steen engineers a completely different life form...
And all of a sudden, your cosmic kitchen becomes this place where you are testing the limits of what life is and what it isn't.
And if life can be different than it is on Earth, think of the possibilities. Life, say, with no water. Life in a cloud, say the clouds of Jupiter. Or any life that we're able to build.
This is a potentially very, very, very powerful technology. If we understand, if we get the key to life, if we understand and control the creative forces in nature, that's a big deal.
But if and when we begin to make life, the question is, can we control it?
Mr. Hammond, I think we're back in business.
I mean, in so many movies, when they make life,
that way,
the experiment gets away from them.
My experiment will get away from me because, in the movie, it got away from them. That's not evidence. But in all fairness to the question, there's no doubt that every advance of human understanding of the universe, of technology, of our power over nature, there's always sort of the other side of that sword, because it's a sword of power. Taking that literally, do we say, you folks who are coming out of the Stone Age into the Bronze Age, don't make the sword, because you can hurt yourself with the sword. You could cut your finger, and that would be bad. Don't make the sword. But they say, oh, but I can use the sword to get food, and I can cut things, and I can build. If everyone throughout the history of human culture listened to the person in the robe who said, don't go there, it is not meant for you, we would still be living in the cave.
By the way, maybe you've noticed, in the old movies, when it's time to zap the monster on the table and bring it to life, they always use lightning. I mean, always. And why? Well, because lightning is electrical. It turns things on, though exactly what lightning does is left to your imagination. Because in the end, what makes life, that's still a mystery. But interestingly, and I didn't know this, it turns out that what makes lightning is also still a mystery. In fact, it's kind of a big mystery. Here's correspondent Chad Cohen.
It's an elemental force of nature, and still one of the most mysterious.
Lightning is very difficult to study. I think we probably understand better how a star explodes halfway across the galaxy than how lightning propagates from 6 miles up.
Lightning strikes the Earth 4 million times a day, and after hundreds of years of scientific scrutiny, we still do not understand the essential secret of how it begins inside a storm.
It's thinning out.
That's why professors Ken Eck and Richard Sonnenfeld and their team from New Mexico Tech are on a 10,000-foot mountain waiting for lightning to strike.
We're trying to find something new about thunderstorms and lightning. That discovery, I think, is worth the risk.
Whatever causes lightning to start has always been hidden inside the clouds, so unlocking that process requires waiting for the weather to reach maximum force, then launching sensitive instruments into the heart of the storm. It's hazardous and frustrating.
Come on out. Go, go. Keep going, keep going. Hey, don't drop it. Don't drop it. Okay, let's go, let's go. Go ahead, you get in position. You get in position. Oh.
Let's go in, right, in, in. It hit the ground.
A thunderstorm has got the energy of an atomic bomb.
Dr. Martin Newman is the director of the International Center for Lightning Testing and Research in Camp Landing, Florida.
It's the brightest light that we see. It's the loudest noise that we hear. The only thing hotter than the lightning on Earth would be a nuclear weapon explosion.
But what triggers the release of all that power? We know that lightning is a huge electric spark, and sparks happen when positive and negative charges build up so much energy they leap through the air to get at each other. It can only happen when the negative charge in that ball on the right and the positive charge in that metal rod on the left get so overwhelmingly strong they cut a path through the air in the middle.
It's like a hose full of pressure and it can't hold on anymore.
That's what most scientists think is happening inside thunderstorms, as ice and water particles collide with each other, moving electric charges to opposite ends of a cloud. When the charge above and the charge below get strong enough, they leap through the air as a bolt of lightning. Except for one thing. When you actually examine the storm cloud, the strength of the positive and negative charges and the electric field around them isn't nearly enough to create that big spark.
Well, the problem is after decades and decades of measurements up in thunderstorms, nobody has ever managed to find an electric field anywhere near that big.
Dr. Joe Dwyer is a professor at Florida Tech.
Well, maybe we're looking for something that doesn't exist. Maybe there's something wrong with our understanding about how electrical discharges get started in places like thunderstorms.
So if thunderclouds, even great big thunderclouds, don't have electric fields big enough to generate the giant spark that lightning actually is, where's all that energy coming from? Well, here in Florida, they have a pretty dramatic way of trying to figure that out. They launch rockets with really long wires attached to try to create that express lane to ground that lightning likes so much. To get lightning from these clouds to strike where scientists can measure it requires a simple trigger.
First of all, you need to have a propellant that can get this thing up there in a hurry. It has to be able to go 700 yards or so in about 2 seconds.
And what is this actually? This is it just copper wire?
It's Kevlar covered copper wire.
Kevlar.
Okay.
So we load it, connect it electrically. When we're about to fire, switches are turned on here manually. After that, everything is done with air pressure from downstairs.
Okay, Casey, tube two is armed. 3, 2, 1, fire.
From 2,000 feet up, the wire triggers lightning with a path to ground higher than the Empire State Building. And when it strikes, over 100 million volts zap the array of test equipment on the ground.
Okay, tube 4 is good. Go ahead and fire 11 when ready.
Tube 11 is armed. 3, 2, 1, fire.
The rockets are, for the first time, allowing physicists to experiment with lightning under repeatable and controllable conditions, so that now Joe Dwyer and other researchers can test an alternate theory of how lightning starts. That theory is called runaway breakdown. Using this model, the energy field inside the storm cloud, that force between positive and negative, too weak to form a bolt of lightning, is struck by outside particles, bursts of electrons, which carry their own energy, very high energy. And with that added energy, you can now get that big spark.
You'll end up with an avalanche of electrons moving near the speed of light. Now, this model will work as long as you have one fast electron to start it off. Sort of the finger that pushes the first domino to get the whole thing started.
And here's where things get really interesting. Joe Dwyer and many other scientists believe that this outside energy force comes not from the clouds, or anywhere else on Earth for that matter, but from cosmic rays, tiny subatomic particles ejected from dying stars millions of years ago and billions of miles away. But how do you test this theory?
We have 10 of these detectors spread out over the facility right now.
Well, it turns out when cosmic particles hit the Earth's atmosphere, they leave a unique signature in the form of gamma and X-rays. If scientists can detect these X-rays, they'll have the proof they need.
This is what's called a sodium iodide detector. There's a piece of crystal in here that will absorb X-rays and gamma rays. I mean, these things are not difficult to measure.
That's where triggered lightning comes in. For the first time, the Florida Research Center's rockets allowed Dwyer to place his X-ray detectors in lightning's path.
Straight up.
He made his first series of measurements in 2002.
A big negative voltage pulse would mean we got a burst of X-rays in the detector. And so I actually didn't think we were going to see X-rays. The first plot we brought up, there was a nice little pulse that looked just like an X-ray right at the time that the lightning occurred. And I thought, that's interesting, you know, that's probably a coincidence, you know, what's the chance of that? So we looked at the next lightning stroke, and there was an even bigger pulse, and the next one, and the next one, and every one had these pulses that looked exactly like X-rays. I think I just about fell out of my chair at that point.
Every single lightning strike Dwyer measured showed the presence of X-rays. But ground measurements can't reach high enough to where lightning actually starts. For that, you need to get instruments right up into the heart of the storm.
We finally have the technology to build these instruments that are small enough and rugged enough to handle the thunderstorm environment.
Lightning is striking all around them. It's time to launch.
one event won't be enough. I mean, if we see an X-ray burst and we call it quits on one event, well, that's not good enough. And it's just going to take a lot of measurements to get in the right spot at the right time.
4, 3, 2, 1, go!
The balloon is sucked into the storm, trailing its cargo of instruments. Launches like these have finally traced X-rays all the way up to where lightning begins, and have given scientists the strongest evidence yet that lightning spark comes from forces outside the Earth itself.
These cosmic rays may be the link which will connect a dying star halfway across the galaxy with lightning.
Thank you, Chad Cohen. And now for our regular segment, Don't Ask the Expert. Astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson said, whatever you do, please do not ask me about Hollywood space aliens. But we did.
Hollywood, don't get me started. Every time they put out an alien, it's for all intents and purposes identically human. If you were a jellyfish and saw the Hollywood aliens, you'd say they looked exactly like human beings. Two arms, two legs, a head, a neck. Maybe they'll give it three eyes instead of two, or antennae. They always have a face, which is a very vertebrate kind of thing to have. So many other life forms on our planet with whom we have DNA in common do not have faces. Trees don't have faces. Worms don't have faces. Jellyfish don't have faces. The list is long. You could draw from our own planet finding creatures that look so unlike us that you'll do better tapping them as alien life forms than anything Hollywood comes up with in all of their movies. And I'm very disappointed. You know what the best Hollywood alien movie has been, in my list? The Blob.
Beware of the blob, it creeps.
The old Steve McQueen movie from the 50s. The Blob. That didn't have a face, did it? And it was just this creature. No, you didn't know why, what made it work. But it loved your blood. Even though it was a B-movie, they did well.
If you were to survey not the universe, just the Earth, you could divide all living creatures into two groups, your smart ones and your not-so-smart ones. So, on the one hand, you would have your dolphins, and you would have your chimps, and we don't want to leave out your dog or your favorite cat. On the other hand, we'd have, moths, slugs, wheat. I mean, wheat's alive, just not all that brainy. But where on this sliding scale of smartness would you put birds? I ask because you're about to meet a scientist who thinks birds can be much, much smarter than other scientists had supposed, and at considerable risk to his career and to his reputation, he decided to make his case. And how he did it, the way he did it, that got our attention.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I present the winner of the 2002 Alan T. Waterman Award. The National Science Foundation's highest honor for the most outstanding young scientist or engineer in America, Dr. Eric Jarvis. As he was 25 years ago in high school.
Now, some of you might be saying, well, how do you link a scientific career to a dancer career? You know, I could do a pirouette. Okay. I even did some African dancing. Well, I won't do that. And I do that. You want to see?
Yes.
Okay. Something like. All right. Okay.
And what he learned training to dance was, in a word,
discipline. Discipline is very, very, very critical for your survival.
As it was for his. Eric didn't go to one of the city's top science-y public schools. Instead, he went here, where they taught him,
dream big, think big, reach for the stars, be ambitious, be bold, and don't let anybody discourage you.
And by the way, you know this school.
Well, the High School of Performing Arts.
Is this the one that's been in the movies? Is this the same high school?
Yeah, a movie called Fame.
Oh, so, I want to live forever.
That's right.
That one.
what was nice about going to a school like this,
says Eric, is you work hard and you get choices.
One choice was I was offered to audition for the Alvin Ailey Dance Company, and I also made it into the City University system, Hunter College. My personal choice was to go into science.
And the science he chose was neuroscience.
Because I'm fascinated with how the brain can generate complex behaviors.
Eric and his colleagues discovered that inside a hummingbird's brain, even though that brain's very tiny and looks so primitive, is a sophisticated neural network that allows hummingbirds to teach each other to sing.
Song in birds is like speech in humans.
This was a breakthrough using molecular biology that Eric learned from her.
Isn't that incredible? I'm the science mother.
The science mother.
The science mother.
Professor Rivka Rudner adopted Eric as an undergraduate.
I also made a cake.
Oh, great.
And he spent not only days at the lab.
There were times in which he would sleep over in the little office adjacent to the lab. You don't find too many kids doing that.
Eric contributed to 6 scientific papers.
As an undergraduate.
So there he is in first position, and all the while, she says, Eric brought an artist's feel to her lab.
You talked about the high that you used to get when you danced. That when you had a performance, uh-huh. You would have a real high.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and then you said, but when I come early in the morning to the lab and open the incubator and look at a plate and see a result to verify, let's say, the co-transduction frequency, I get a high, just right. Like I used to get when I danced.
And he kept dancing. He met a girl, Miriam, whom he later married. He graduated, and then his father died.
He was shot. So he was shot while he was sitting down, they think he was sitting down, near a cave.
James Jarvis was homeless, divorced. He'd been living in caves, like this one that Eric visited in northern Manhattan. They never found his killers.
This is the richness of what represented him.
Eric's dad collected rocks and fossils and odd specimens. He was not a well man. But Eric visited him, and more than his brothers and sister, he kept that connection.
Eric has always been the mediator out of his siblings.
When times were tough, they all had to live together at the grandparents' house.
That I euphemistically call the refugee house, because everybody who had problems in the family would live in that house. But it brought a whole bunch of cousins together, an extended family that I basically not only had my brothers and sisters, but a whole bunch of cousins.
And from time to time, he took care of most of them. This habit of partnering and supporting is fundamental to Eric, but it's not a very common way to succeed in science. Science is a me culture, my paper, my lab, my discovery. Eric was playing the me game very well, but when a problem came up that could only be solved by bringing the many me's together, Eric would have to choose between bettering his career or his community. Here's the problem. This is a classic bird brain illustration by a German neurologist, Ludwig Edinger, in 1903. The names that Edinger gave to these brain parts that have been used now for 100 years use Latin roots like primitive, ancient, not as smart as people, suggesting that birds can't learn. But if all birds have primitive brains, then how do you explain Betty the Crow? She's at Oxford University, and a few years ago, scientists put a basket of delicious meat inside the cylinder, and the question was, could Betty take the wire resting there and use it to fish out the meat? Well, here's Betty, and she's picking up a wire that's straight, so that's not going to work, but she's going to try. And then jump forward a minute, she's jamming the wire against the tray wall. But look, you see, it's bent now, so she drops it in. Success.
I do think that this little bird is doing this with the intent to get the food.
So she's bending it to get
the food. I do believe that.
So they tried 10 times more. Here, Betty is bending the straight wire by walking and pushing. And 9 out of 10 times, she did make a tool that worked.
That's tool making.
Harvey Carton, a leader in this field, thought,
we hadn't normally even considered that birds were that capable.
Old Edinger, with his century-old bias that birds are stupid, apparently had it wrong. And if his labels were calling birds primitive and dumb, and then the bird goes off and plays chess, that leaves everybody, including scientists, confused.
I would get emails from other scientists who aren't aware of the problem, and they email me and say, how could hummingbirds do all this complex behavior that they describe with a brain dominated only by the primitive substance?
Now, there aren't a lot of scientists who are passionate about this, but the group that is really is. So, as necessary as it was, changing the names was likely to get very ugly if it could happen at all. It would take someone who was collaborative by nature and might get all of these solo characters to dance to one beat. It would take you know who.
I'll do it if you guys let me do it.
I mean, that's good. That's like asking for trouble.
I felt that it was necessary, and it was my naiveness of a young professor coming to Duke. You know, this just has to change. It was a moral thing for me to do. Changing these names wasn't easy.
First, he got them together by email, and it turned out, well, it was a complete mess. I am simply shocked, said one. My name should not appear, says another.
I don't want to make this personal, says one of them, but... Blah, blah, blah.
And when they got together, things didn't go much better.
People running to get the dictionaries and then the developmental neuroanatomists were supporting of this viewpoint. And then the functional neuroanatomists were saying, no, but that's peripheral to the common understanding. So we had great, great drama. And I remember Eric kind of watching it all.
And it is exactly at this moment that Eric's lifetime of training kicks in.
Eric managed to let people voice their say. He did in a very, very intelligent way. He knew when not to talk. He knew when to listen.
When they shouted, he did this. When they stomped, he did that. They quit, he turned. They screamed, he twirled. And by the end of the conference, with Eric's leadership, they came up with new names that everyone had agreed upon.
Oh, it would not have happened. I honestly don't think that it would have happened at this time without him.
It has been accepted. At least 100 papers have been published since on bird brains. And I would say about 95 to 98% of them, and I'm trying not to be too conservative here, have used a new nomenclature.
Now, you might think that a triumph like this under his belt would have been a good thing for Eric, but Eric may in fact have to pay a price for his contribution.
I get criticized for it. I get openly criticized for being too collaborative sometimes.
Eric is at the very moment in his career when his field would have him focus on his lab work and publishing to make his name. There's less reward in science for those who have a talent for leading others.
I think to some degree he gave up some of the essential things several of us felt he should be concentrating on to get his own papers out rather than working on this. But, you know, that's a choice he made.
What's most important for me is that the scientific accomplishment get accomplished.
He thinks broadly to see the big picture.
For Eric, this was his big picture, the gathering of scientists to improve all their work.
The photograph that I have in my mind shows you at the center of all these people. Did you orchestrate that?
Yes, I did. The reason for taking the photograph was to show the rest of the community, the scientific community, that we are in unison on this, okay? Uh-huh. And then I thought about it, I says, wait a minute, this is not unison enough.
So the choreographer in Eric Jarvis took over. He convinced these 28 scientists who'd been yelling at each other for the past 3 days that for the sake of unity, for the sake of science, they needed to take one more step.
We hold hands, okay? Uh-huh. And so that then even shows more our unity.
And perhaps it'll show some of the leaders in Eric's community that sometimes what even science needs is a little more heart.
A happy little postscript here. Eric Jarvis was just awarded one of the National Institute of Health's coveted Pioneer Awards, $500,000 a year to his lab for the next 5 years. So he took the risk, and somebody noticed.
The great Harvard biologist E.O. Wilson said, one of the things that makes us special, in good part makes us human, he wrote,
is that we have a deep, rich connection to other living things, what he calls biophilia, the love of other organisms. And even if you get the creeps when you see a snake or a cockroach or a rat, even if there are animals that you do not like, chances are there are animals that you love. And then there are some of you, and we know who you are because we sent our correspondent Rebecca Skloot to look. There are some of you whose love for animals is... Well, why don't you see for yourself?
We need 200 ml.
See that? Just a gentle pinch.
We're half a minute into induction of anesthesia.
In this high-tech operating room, surgeons, some of the top in their field, prepare to remove a large tumor, probably malignant. One doctor tests the laser he'll use to burn away abnormal cells. Another preps the patient for surgery. Meet Comet, a one-pound goldfish with skin cancer.
Well, we can't operate underwater, so we put it on our anesthesia machine where it's out of the water, and then the tubes go into its mouth, and then the water with a little bit less concentration of anesthetic flow over the gills, and they stay asleep while we work on them.
I like to look at his gills, see how nice and red they are.
Dr. Greg Lubart runs the world's first aquatic medicine residency program at North Carolina State University's veterinary school. It's a new field, so he and his colleagues are big on firsts. First fish laser surgery, first study on fish pain management. They even invented the machine keeping Comet knocked out.
We can do radiographs or x-rays. We do ultrasound, CAT scans. We can even do MRIs. I don't think there are any limits on it, other than what physically can be done with that animal, and then what the owners can afford or are willing to spend.
And apparently, they're willing to spend a lot. Anywhere from a few hundred to a couple thousand dollars.
Okay, Comet, you're almost done.
But why pay for laser surgery on a goldfish? Comet's probably worth about 10 cents.
Here's something that might surprise you. More Americans own fish than dogs or cats these days. But what's more interesting is that people's attitudes about fish are actually changing. They're not just things you keep around the house for decoration anymore. These are pets, companions that people bond with, care about.
Guys, look at you, huh?
Debbie Corpus has 27 fish. Some are rescue fish, ones she found flopping in a field after kids turned over their tank, or party favors she saved from wrongful death by toilet flushing.
Do different fish have different personalities?
Oh, yes.
Some are like this guy. He's very bold and outgoing. You know, I talk to him and tell him what's going on, and he would, you know, come up to the surface and just listen to me. He really responds to people.
I really do think there is a human-fish interaction. Fish are pretty smart. I don't think we give them enough credit a lot of times. They can be trained to do some pretty amazing things. There's a book that teaches you how to train your goldfish to swim through a hoop, to fetch, to play basketball.
So I can see that mass a lot better now.
Today, there are more than 2,000 fish vets. So if your goldfish gets a buoyancy disorder that leaves it swimming perpetually upside down, someone can implant a piece of cork on your fish's back, like a flotation device that flips it right side up. And if your fish loses a fight, well, there's always glass eye implantation to make it beautiful again.
When someone brings their fish in to me, I look at that fish like it's their dog or it's their horse.
Healthy.
I think if they could pick them up and hold them, they would.
Ooh.
Dave Smothers will tell you he really loves his fish. He raises koi, the mythical Japanese carp that fill decorative ponds. Some just look like big goldfish. Others are the elegant koi he wins trophies with at fish shows. They can be worth tens of thousands of dollars, but for Smothers, it's not about the money.
I would do anything I could to try to help these fish because they are our pets, and you do attach to them emotionally.
In the summer of 2001, lightning struck near Smothers Pond, sending a violent electrical current into the water. It nearly killed Ladyfish, one of his favorites. They did a series of CAT scans. Her back was broken.
The fish certainly was going to die. There was no doubt about that.
The decision was made to bring her to surgery, a neurosurgeon and an orthopedic surgeon. The surgeons weren't able to straighten the spine, but they were able to stabilize it using screws and wires and some surgical epoxy or cement that actually is implanted above the spinal column inside of the fish.
What was it that made you want to do that?
This fish would never be a showfish now because of the deformity. I just wanted the fish to live out its natural life as best she could, swimming around with her buddies in the pond.
When I was in veterinary school, if someone had brought their fish into the clinic for abdominal surgery, it would have like blown a lot of people away. Now, if I bring a fish, wheel it through the clinic, you know, it's not as huge of a deal.
Okay, so maybe fish surgery still sounds a little crazy, but think about this.
In the 30s, you were crazy if you took your dog to the vet. You didn't treat those, you shot them. And in the 80s, taking a bird to the vet was completely ridiculous, and now avian medicine's mainstream.
So maybe 20 years from now, your grandkids will be taking their snails to the vet and saying, "Can you believe people used to flush their fish down the toilet?"
Earlier this year, Nova Science Now took a detailed look at the risks facing New Orleans should it be hit by a big hurricane. We talked to scientists, and they said, we now have the tools to see a big one coming, to measure its force, to warn officials. We can give our city precious time to prepare. So after Katrina, we wondered, well, did those scientists see it coming? Did they know its power? We sent our correspondent, Peter Standring, to find out.
This was New Orleans the last time I saw it, about a year ago. Back then, the streets of this historic city were alive, buzzing with the sounds of music and laughter, and the Crescent City was in all of her glory. But things then were a lot different than they are today.
I was here in New Orleans at this same time last year to file a report on hurricanes for Nova Science Now. I talked to scientists and emergency management officials about what would happen if this city were to be hit by a major hurricane, Category 4 or 5. They all agreed that the consequences would be catastrophic.
On August 29th, all of their worst fears and premonitions became reality when the killer storm Katrina smashed into the Gulf Coast and the city of New Orleans.
The good news is that this wasn't the worst of the worst-case scenario. The bad news is that even the best of the worst-case scenario for this community resulted in what you see.
Just the year before, a state and federal emergency exercise was undertaken based on a computer model of likely scenarios called Hurricane Pam. On August 27th, with Katrina approaching, Ivor Van Heerden and a team from Louisiana State University plugged the latest data from the storm into the model.
The last one we did showed that New Orleans was actually going to flood. I then sent an email to a lot of different federal agencies, state agencies, the media.
Just as they had planned in the exercises. But the next day, he questioned whether the federal agencies in charge of disaster management had paid any attention to the warnings, in particular, the Army Corps of Engineers, charged with monitoring the levees.
The Corps should have been monitoring the levees, and they should have warned everybody when they let go. People went to bed on Monday evening, houses dry, and woke up with water up to their waists.
As the water poured out from the broken levees on the Industrial, London, and 17th Street canals, turning New Orleans into a lake, Ivor's dismay only increased.
I was very angry. I sent out an email to my friends and family. You know, trying to voice my frustration and trying to voice my pain because, you know, we called this thing right. And literally nobody wanted to listen. The bigger problem is that I don't think, under the present situation of disaster management in this country, that the scientists are really taken seriously.
One of the things we forgot is that Katrina is a terrorist. And that terrorist approaches the coastal states every year. We've got to be ready to protect ourselves with all the resources at our disposal, or you're going to see this again and again and again, if not here, in other coastal great old cities across the country.
Special thanks to Louisiana Public Broadcasting for their assistance in the production of this report.
Nova Science Now continues 365 days a year online at pbs.org. You can watch any part of this broadcast or our previous episodes again online. You can email us, ask us questions, write the scientists who are working on artificial life, on fish medicine, on lightning. You can talk to us and tell us what you think, because we want to hear what you think. I'm Robert Krulwich. Goodbye.
Nova is a production of WGBH Boston.